Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to the Wall of Power. I'm your host, Paul Metza. My guest tonight for the whole show is Mr. Kieran Folliard. Kieran is a legendary Minneapolis restaurateur, entrepreneur, and a shaker and mover in the food, beverage, and hospitality industry. He founded Kieran's Pub over 25 years ago, one of the finest Irish pubs in Minneapolis, and then ran the local, an establishment in downtown Minneapolis that sold more Jameson whiskey daily than anywhere in the world. He ran four other establishments, sold them 6 years ago, and founded Two Gingers Irish Whiskey. We've been barroom buddies for years. In 2011, my book, Blue Guitar Highway, was published, and Kieran was kind enough to supply the 200 folks at my book release party at the Ritz Theater in Northeast Minneapolis with generous samples of Two Gingers whiskey that was just making its way into the market. A year later, Two Gingers was in 2,000 bars, restaurants, and liquor stores. He turned around and sold it to Jim Beam Incorporated, and they made him their whiskey ambassador, a job that makes this Iron Ranger extremely jealous. And with no further ado, my buddy, Kieran Folliard. Kieran, good
Paul,
to see you, man.
How you doing?
I'm doing great. You've always got something going on, something new. What's the latest in your world?
Oh, really? A lot of dogfights. Well, food building. I'm still heavily involved with Two Gingers Irish Whiskey,
right,
and do a lot of work for that brand around the country and mm-hmm. specifically here in Minnesota. But also then food building just around the corner from where we are, and we've got a couple of nice artisan food businesses in there. Red Table Meat Company, a salumi business, pigs from small farms here in Minnesota, and whole hog production and really national award-winning products being produced there. Mike Phillips is my partner in that business, and then Steve Horton, my partner in Bakersfield Flour and Bread. Stone milling of flour back in the Mill City.
We are the Mill City.
And then also breads, and getting great support from from the co-ops in particular.
Right.
And
you're a business incubator in a way. You know, you get a lot of these things started. And now, is that open to the public, the food building?
Yeah, you can wander in around, have a look in through their windows into the production facility,
right,
in there, and then you can stop into our friends at the Draft Horse, which is part of the building, and they have a restaurant in there, Luke and Katie Kyle. Luke is also involved with the Anchor just around.
Oh, yeah, I know, Luke, sure.
Sure.
So what is it, what's the address?
1401 Marshall Street, Northeast.
Okay, great. I've never figured out what is the correct spelling of whiskey. Do you need the E before the Y or not? I've seen it both ways.
Of course you do.
Okay.
We're Irish. We invented the whiskey, so it is, way back in the day. And I like to joke that our friends, our cousins over in Scotland, they'd be still barrel-aging water if it wasn't for the Irish inventing whiskey. And then they were too cheap to put an E in there as well. The Irish were very generous people.
So now, tell us about when you were a kid in Ireland. You started working for your dad. Was he a taxi driver? What did he have?
He was. He had a hackney car, they called
okay.
it. And we also had a field where we grew all of our own vegetables. Everything that you can imagine that grows in Ireland, we grew it in that field.
Hmm.
And he was a man of few words, but the few he used were always taken to heart. He used to say to me, if you don't want to do it right, don't do it at all.
Right.
And I'd say, fine, I won't. I'm like 12. And then he'd say, get back there and finish that job.
And then he said something about, what's the way he phrased it, you're going to be dead for a long time.
Oh, no, you'll be a long time dead.
Long time dead.
Long time dead.
Yeah. Well, that must have really kind of imprinted into your psyche, because you're moving 365 days a year.
Yeah, we're certainly.
Plus, you run 365 days a year too. You're a runner, right?
Oh, God, Paul, that was back in the day. About 4 years ago, really. And since I started doing all of this business stuff, going in a lot of different directions, the old fitness has, I don't know.
All downhill.
I need to get back to it, though.
Yeah.
Yes.
Well, you look good.
My wife keeps threatening me. Ah, now, You haven't seen me without any clothes on, Paul.
Well, the night's young.
Oh, dear. Yeah, the bottle is still full.
Kieran, wait. I remember, you know, I just lost my dog, Blackie, and yes. you and I were talking a few years ago. But you were telling me about your dog, Blackie, when you were a kid.
Yes.
Tell us about, you said you used to come home from school and box him.
Oh, my God. I'd be out in the field, and I literally would have boxing gloves on. There was a boxing club started in the town. And Blackie would run around in a perfect circle, and I'm in the middle. And then he'd take a run at me, and he'd jump, and I was boxing at him. Then he'd run around again, take another run at me. And he was, you know. We should have put him in the circus.
Was he? What is he? A border collie? What was
oh,
he?
Oh God, no! He was
just
a mutt. He was a mutt.
Yeah,
yeah, yeah. Fantastic dog.
Yeah.
Great dog.
Tell us a little bit about how long did you stay in Ireland after high school?
Well, I went to college in Galway to the regional college there, and then after that,
what did you study?
Work. What did I study? Oh, my family are going to see this. Well, it might have been a little Drop of Guinness involved at the cellar bar. So there was marketing was really, I suppose, the main kind of subject. But yeah, it's not like education nowadays that my kids have gone through university and so forth. You know,
right.
It was I played a lot of Gaelic football and spent probably too much time in the pub, which doesn't really qualify you for anything other than I suppose. You know, conversation and having a good time.
Mm-hmm.
But I worked in Ireland for a short time after that, and then I ended up going to work in Riyadh and Saudi Arabia.
Yeah, what
an
was
Irish
that
food
about?
Company, launching a dairy product brand called Almarai Farms in the middle of the desert, central pivot irrigation systems from Nebraska, cows flown in from California by the Flying Tigers and producing milk.
Wow.
Now it's a massive company today. I was out there in the very beginning in 1977 with it. Alistair and Paddy McGuckian were the owners, and I'm still very close to three of the guys I went out there and worked with back in the day.
Wow. So how long was that then?
I was there 77, 78, 79.
Okay.
Ended up coming to America in 87.
What brought you to Minneapolis?
Well, I tell you, it was the weather, Paul. So it was. It was the weather. So it was.
And you love road construction.
Well, I like to say, I like to say that I've been here 30 years, wandering around lost in the tundra, which is better than wandering around lost in the desert. I came for a year or two and still here. It's a pretty good place to be, the Twin Cities.
What? When did you start Kieran's Pub when it was downtown?
Well, I remember the dates of everything, so
okay.
I do. And arrived here April 16th, 1987.
Okay.
Opened the pub, Kieran's, on March 16th, 1994.
Wow.
People have often asked me, and they wouldn't be particularly Irish, how come March 16th? Well, I said, if you opened it on the 18th, you'd be really the stupidest Irish person, given St. Patrick's Day
on
the
17th. Right. So you're all set for the big opening. What did you do from the time you got to Minneapolis till the time you opened Kieran's Pub?
I was with Dennis Anderson. He had a company called Endcore, which was in the executive search business, but he primarily focused on startup companies.
Okay.
And taking equity in those companies in lieu of fees, or partly equity as well. So I got to meet a lot of the people, you know, Scotty Olson with Rollerblade and
the
Sleep Number bed companies. Select Comfort, I think it was called at the time, and the Breed Right people, and it was a fascinating time. There were so many innovative and really creative people in this marketplace.
I've got about five real regrets in my time here in Minneapolis, and one of them was I didn't go see Tommy Makeham.
Oh, sure.
At Kieran's. Yeah. Yeah. That must have been a magical night.
It was. He was a fantastic character. I mean, a great storyteller.
Right.
Beyond a great musician as well. And, you know, he had spent time with the Clancy brothers, of course, out with your neighbor up in northern Minnesota, Virginia, with
Bobby Dylan.
Bobby Dylan,
Out in Greenwich Village, spent some time. Mm-hmm. Quality time those guys used to throw down at the White Horse Tavern.
At the White Horse Tavern.
Have you been there?
I have been to the White Horse Tavern because I'm a big fan of Dylan Thomas, and of course he was a staple there for many years.
He was in fact
the Chelsea Hotel.
Yeah, When I went to, when I was in Greenwich Village years ago, I went to the White Horse because he died. He fell off a stool there and died of what the coroner said was a severe insult to the brain from all the boozing. But I asked the bartender, I said, which stool was Dylan Thomas on the night he passed? And he said, you're sitting in it.
And you're still here. And that's a good thing. Good man.
And I'm still here to tell the story.
Yeah.
More stories with Kieran Folliard on The Wall of Power after these messages. You're back with The Wall of Power. This is your host, Paul Metsa, with me in the studio for the whole show tonight, Mr. Kieran Folliard. Kieran, what do you like about Minneapolis? You came here in 87. You never left.
Paul, this isn't whiskey. This isn't two gingers. What's going on here?
We're going to get to two gingers.
That's water, for God's sake.
But what did you love about Minneapolis?
It's very accessible, and that was something that was important because, you know, my parents, my mother's been still alive, access to getting back and so forth. So having
right.
the international airport here was important. But outside of that, I mean, it was a terrific place to live in terms of it's got what a great balance of things like the education system, the arts, the music scene, sports. I mean, there isn't really anything here that you could want for
right.
the outdoors. I mean, it's really a very kind of a passionate place when it comes to the extremes of the weather. And so I think that helps just your lifestyle and so forth.
Right.
Yeah.
And really four seasons. That. So you have the, it's not like LA where it's just so
five late. Seasons. Don't forget that road construction stuff.
Boy, there's a lot of it this
lot
summer.
Of it. Oh my God.
Drives you nuts. Mm. What about, I was doing a little reading research on you, and you don't have you haven't had a television for 10 years.
Well, that I didn't have for 10 years, but okay. now I have one.
Okay.
Because I wanted to watch the World Cup, and I wasn't
okay.
in the pubs anymore. I didn't have the pubs anymore, so that's where I would watch it all the time. Now, I still got to watch the big games, particularly Irish games, or the U.S. playing down at the pub, but for the other games. And so I had to get a TV. Now, I don't have cable, and so mostly I use it for watching movies, I guess.
Right. So you...
I didn't grow up with a television, so that was part of it.
Right. Your dad probably wasn't interested in that either.
Well, really, almost nobody had a television.
Right.
I remember Tom Hopkins, Tom and Rita, had the little shop down in the village, and they had a television, and I would go there. I remember going to see The Virginian on a Saturday night.
Oh, cool.
James Turing and Doug McClure.
Sure.
Now,
Doug McClure,
it may have
right.
been that or the fact that they had seven daughters as well. God's honest truth.
Well, that's yeah. Well, you how'd you meet your wife?
I met her here. I actually met her at First Avenue.
Okay.
A friend of ours. I was there with my buddy Stuart Higgins, one of the owners of Brit's Pub, and we were there to see Huilo. It's no longer around, but my friend of mine, Paul Horan, who has Gear Running Store at 44th and France, right
okay.
in that area, he knew both of us independently, and he says that he orchestrated it to make sure that we would meet.
Well,
and so we went there to support him and the band that night, and
right.
we met, and two marriages later to each other, we're still together.
Wonderful. Well, you got to give her my best.
I love
chatting with her. Yeah, gorgeous
yeah,
as
yeah,
well.
Yeah, lovely. And I'm passionate about music.
Yeah, I know sort of, that. Yeah. And you're passionate about music. What were some of the bands you when you started digging music when you were a kid growing up? What were you listening to over in Ireland?
I mean, Horselips was probably the
okay.
The ones that really kind of changed me around, because country and western was probably the biggest thing when I was like a teenager growing up
mm-hmm.
in the dance halls, the ballroom of romance.
Right.
And,
right.
So Big Tom and the Mainliners, the Indians, the Hoedowners, these were all Irish country and western
hmm.
bands. I mean, it's still relatively popular, but then Horselips came along and they were doing Celtic rock
mm-hmm.
and they changed the whole scene in Ireland.
Wow.
And obviously a Thin Lizzy and
right.
a bunch of us, Skid Row, were around as well. And yeah.
Did you ever get a chance to see back in the days, bands like The Clash or The Sex Pistols, did they make it to to Ireland?
I'm sure they did make it to Ireland, but they certainly didn't make it to my village in the west of Ireland. So they didn't. But, I mean, I was familiar with them because we would listen to Radio Luxembourg.
Right.
And that was the pirate station back in the day, and shifted them out onto the Atlantic or the North Sea in a boat. And so it was the cool thing to do, to try and listen into Radio Luxembourg.
How old did you have to be in Ireland to go into the pubs? Did you have to be 21 back then? When did you start sneaking in?
If you went into the pub in Ireland when I was like 15 and 16, and it was not really what age you were, it was, could you actually pay for the pint? If you could pay for the pint. 18 was the rule, and certainly would be much more enforced nowadays.
Mm-hmm.
Certainly the laws are much stricter, and for some good reasons, but it's more about drink driving.
We've got Kieran Folliard. We'll be back after these messages. You're back with The Wall of Power. This is your host, Paul Metza. My guest for the whole show tonight, my buddy, Kieran Folliard. Kieran, tell us about this other buddy in a little drinking adventure.
Oh, Matt Morley. Well, he wasn't really a buddy. He was much older.
Okay.
But Matt was a big man, well over 6 feet, and coming in at a pretty good weight also. But he was the first guy in our whole area to buy a scooter, mm-hmm. a Honda 50. And it was outside the pub one night, and a bunch of the lads came out, and they're saying, oh, God, how's the Honda 50? And how's it working out for you, and so forth? And you see the size of Matt besides this Honda 50. And they said, how's it working for you? And he says, it can carry myself and 15 pints comfortably.
That's all you needed to know.
Yeah, but that, again, a different era.
Right.
I mean, you wouldn't encourage anything along those lines today, but this is in a rural west of Ireland, and I suppose, different times.
Well, different times. And of course, we want to remind our audience to drink responsibly when
absolutely.
Well, speaking of drinking responsibly, let's talk about Two Gingers. This is your whiskey that came out in 2011, I believe in the fall of 2011. And tell us, where'd you get the idea for it and the name, and how did this all come about?
Well, really at the local, we had promoting Irish whiskey in general, because being an Irish pub, you want people to have the full experience of what maybe the things they would do when they go to Ireland and so forth. Whiskey was not big when I was growing up. It was really your father, your grandfather's drink.
Mm-hmm.
And that's all changed even in these 6-7 years, I guess.
Right.
So we were selling a lot of Irish whiskey. The prices kept going up. And we couldn't put the prices up on the particular brand of Irish whiskey at the rate that it was going up. So I contacted our friends at what was the Cooley Kilbeggan Distillery in Ireland at the time, and talked to them about, producing our own blend and our own brand of Irish whiskey.
Hmm.
And went over, sat down with them for a couple of days, hashed it out, and Noel Sweeney was a master distiller at the time. He was from County Mayo, where I'm from. He was also the blender, and he's actually just been inducted into the Whiskey Hall of Fame.
Wow.
The most recent inductee into it, and a terrific guy, very, very talented. And so we decided to launch it, and we launched it in the pubs on March 16th, once again, 2011. And it really, originally, was only going to be in the pubs.
Right.
And but honestly, it just went down very, very well, no pun intended, with the customers. And obviously they looked at what they had been drinking prior to this and the other Irish brands of whiskey,
mm-hmm.
and doing a lot of taste test comparisons. And it was winning out in a higher percentage of the cases. And so decided, going to launch it out in the marketplace, and you can't do both. So I sold my share in the business, mostly to the people actually who had worked with me for many years.
Mm-hmm.
Peter Killen now runs the pubs, but there were many other people directly involved and all doing a great job with helping to get it launched. But I took it out into the market and launched it later that year around Thanksgiving.
How did you, it was an incredible success early on.
Yeah, well, it was a lot of hard work, but obviously, anything that's has some success to it. There's a lot of people involved. And,
right.
You know, I had my buddy Liam Scott came along as head of sales, and Kerry, and there were so many different people. Well,
right.
Not so many. I mean, there were only, I think, seven of us at the time. And yeah, we did a lot of tastings. I think we did over 300 tastings.
Wow.
In a short period of time at liquor stores and bars, really, across Minnesota.
And the name Two Gingers, where did that come
from? Coming up, well, we had a trademark drink called Big Ginger.
Okay.
And looking for it, had to be something Irish, so we're thinking of the red hair.
Right.
And then the Two Gingers, my mother and my aunt, God rest them. As I like to joke, they can't refute anything I have to say about them, because they're both dead. Although my sister, God rest her too, unfortunately, passed away earlier this year.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Very... very sad situation, my only sibling. But she said, when I said that to her about my aunt and my mother, she said, oh, well, I wouldn't be too sure now, and Delia might come down and hit you with a bolt of lightning. She had a good edge to her. But they lived to the late 80s, early 90s,
right.
90 years of age.
And your aunt Delia, she, I was doing some reading, and that she smoked and drank.
Pretty much to the bitter end.
It is. God
traveled
bless her.
The world, never married, worked for the government in Dáil Éireann, in our parliament, all of those years, and she was still doing the cryptic crossword in the Irish Times well into her 80s.
How many kids do you have?
I have four.
Wow. What are their ages?
Three are in their 30s. The two boys work with me, and Seamus and Tyrone. And my daughter Vienna just had a second grandchild.
Oh, that's a beautiful name, Vienna.
Vienna, yes, and she has to
after
find
the city?
Irish. After her grandmother on her mother's side.
Okay.
And
I've never heard that name. It's a perfect name for a woman.
Yes, it is, for sure. And she and her husband Alex, they have Eamon and Aisling.
Wow.
Two good Irish names.
Nice.
And then my son Tyrone and his husband Michael, they just adopted a boy, Declan.
Wow.
6 weeks ago.
Man.
Beautiful little fella. So he is.
Well,
so
good for
all
you.
The good Irish names.
Yeah, good for you, Grandpa.
Yeah, thank you. And
so,
India, I have a daughter India as well.
Oh,
and
nice.
She's a terrific kid. There she is.
Well, you put out Two Gingers in 2011. And it's amazing now, in these last 6 years, every time you turn around a corner, there's a new brew pub. So there's this whole environment that's kind of coming on board. How do you've seen it? What do you think is driving that?
So, I mean, I think what people are really looking for, they are looking for the authenticity, they're looking for the variety, they're looking for, you know, the story that's in there with it. And I think it's just kind of exciting. It makes a place much more interesting. It's like having all different varieties of music and food and art, and it's like whatever it speaks to you. And so some people like a particular style of beer, hoppier, and some other people more Pilsner style, etc. And I think you find the same thing with liquor and now in the food business as well.
I gotta get back to a little bit. When you're formulating the recipe for Two Gingers, does the distiller go, here, try this, we're gonna put a little more of this in this one, or how do you come up with the final ingredients, the balance?
Certainly, when you have somebody like an Noel Sweeney, you trust them. Certainly, my input to it would have been the input of, you know, who is the customer that we're looking to attract. And the customer that we wanted it for was really for people who were not in the whiskey world, so to speak.
Right.
They were people that just wanted a really good product. And actually, Wine Spectator gives us a 94, which is the highest blended rating for a blended Irish whiskey, ahead of all the other better known brands.
Mm-hmm.
See, I don't mention those other brands. I only mention Two Gingers.
Right.
So I do.
Yeah, I've actually brought some up to my brother's got a lodge in northern Minnesota, and a lot of he's a big duck hunter, and so I brought that up. I said, whiskey up your coffee cup with this when you go to the duck blind.
He loves it. And then he'll miss the duck.
Kieran, thank you so much, my friend.
Thank you. You're a fantastic character and terrific musician, and it's exciting to see how you continue to innovate and do all the great things that you do.
Well, I'm too old.
You're a Minnesota treasure.
Thank you, Kieran. Well, and I'm too old to join the FBI.